Hello, everyone. I'm Kathleen Riley, and I'm here to have a conversation and to share some beautiful music of our wonderful singer-songwriter, iconic artist, Melissa Manchester. And I'm so excited that she is joining us for this special 20th annual World Sound Healing Day. And I'd like to invite us in before Melissa shares her messages and her music, for us to just gather together around the globe for a few moments in a heart meditation. For we do bring our hearts together on this special day. And we gather, appreciating each other and really tuning in through our hearts to our commonalities. Knowing that we are all creatures of sound. We are all music, even if it's through the tone of our voices. So we plant our seeds in that heart garden for what we are to share with one another in restoring humanity and our world. And these are the seeds of love, kindness, appreciation, gratitude, patience, forgiveness. Feeling those penetrate within ourselves for any pieces that are out of alignment with us, for us to tune. And then we share these outward. So that every one of our thoughts, actions, and words, and our beautiful music may touch deeply the souls of all. Melissa, it is such a dear pleasure to visit with you again. And I'm just so excited that you're learning and now becoming a part of this co-creation.
It's wonderful to be part of your co-creation. Thank you so much.
Yeah,
for inviting me to this loveliness.
Yes, it is indeed. And, you know, maybe we could just start with we're going to take everyone on a sound journey today. Mm-hmm. But for you to maybe share a message with our world from your heart of what you would like to share for today.
Well, music has always been sort of like breath to me. It's always been in my home growing up. It's always been the central force of my journey. And what I have learned from what it is I do through the experiences of what audiences have told me over and over again, is that somehow what I do, and the vehicle being the music, of course, is that I give people permission to remember things that they didn't realize they had forgotten. Things that were not finally processed, grief, hurt, abandonment, neglect, but also that I serenaded them in the joyful moments. And so that's what music has been for me. I have been offering a service through music. That's it. I mean, music is so mysterious. And the opportunities of what it opens are just unbelievable. So I am happy to be a part of that. I'm happy to be in service of that. I'm happy and grateful that that's what people get from what I do and what I've been doing for a long time now.
Yes. And it's just wonderful for us to be together. So yeah, let's just have a little more of our conversation about what you were sharing. Touched me so deeply because truly I can remember songs, many of yours, in addition to even pieces of classical music that I first played as a pianist, and then others that I heard, and what music has brought into my life. And of course, you know, those moments for remembering.
Absolutely.
And it's just such a healing balm.
Yes, it is. I mean, you know, I remember being, I don't know, maybe nine, and I first heard Gershwin's Concerto in F, and I don't know what it released in me, but the tears, it's not that I was crying, I wasn't crying, but the tears were coming down. Mm-hmm. The tears were letting loose, and I'd never, as you know, as I recall at the tender age of nine, I never remember that happening to my little soul, just opening and, you know, sort of spirit coming through the tears. And it was so deep. It was so deep. It was like when I first heard Ella Fitzgerald, it was so deep. And I had no words to articulate what it was that I was, what I was responding to, but I took it, I guess, as a sign, because the imprint of that feeling was something I wanted to follow. Because the joy, the serious joy of it, you know, the heavenly outpouring only came through that tonality and that those combinations of sounds. And it was really a sign for me, you know, Gershwin and Ella and Puccini.
Yes.
And Chopin, a lot of Chopin. Those were very early guides. I mean, they were lighting a path that I didn't know was in front of me. That's the thing about paths. You don't know that you're on a path until you're well onto the path.
That's so true.
It's and you're, so you know, true. You're hoping that there's light, and then you find the light, and the light is from the signs along the way.
Right.
Whether it's a guide or, you know, something that the universe, I believe, provides, you know, things that keep repeating, yes, which shows you that this is your lesson to learn so that you don't keep repeating that. But in terms of the mystery of music, the power of music and its spiritual instruction, you know, it's always there. And that's why, in my opinion, and in science's opinion, it's so important to be playing beautiful music to little ones as soon as possible, and just keep it on, you know, don't make it a focus where everybody's sitting around, you know, a radio, but just have it playing at dinner time quietly so that it just softens the air, you know.
Yes. And that just really calls into my heart, you know, just that what you're speaking about, those moments of inspiration.
Yes.
And, you know, I'm feeling called to have you, have everyone listen to one of your beautiful early songs and inspirations. Sure. That is so touching and speaks so beautifully.
Thank you. Okay, let's talk us into this. This is a video, a re-recording of a song that I wrote quite a while ago with Carol Sager. We were writing partners for 5 years, and we wrote a song in the 70s called Just You and I. And one of the mysteries, I know we talked about this before, but one of the mysteries that I've experienced recently were songs of mine from way past that have grown into this moment of the pandemic, of giving value to workers that were marginalized, and now they become, you know, indispensable. So this version of Just You and I, with new harmonics that I just grew into, and a choral background of beautiful young students from Citrus Community College, where I'm artist in residence, the Citrus Singers. They infused just you and I with a heightened spirit, an anthemic spirit, honestly, to pay tribute to first responders, to delivery people, to mail people, to pizza delivery people, to doctors, to nurses, to frontline workers, all, and also to bring forth the good that we can do as a nation when we share a vision from the top down, specifically citing the WPA works of Franklin Delano Roosevelt and his remarkable wife, Eleanor, and all of the progressive programs they put in place during the terrible 1930s, the Depression, to get people working and to jumpstart this nation. So this is just you and I.
When your heroes go up in a puff, and there's not enough to hang on to, and the ones you would count on to call, they all fall down all around you, then you've got to believe there's more. It is the reason we're put here for. There's just you and I. We can look to each other to see us through, just you and I. When a miracle's long overdue, and there's no one who's gonna come to guide you, keep looking up to the sky, wondering why the clouds won't hide you at the times when you're most afraid. That is the reason why dreams are made. There's just you and
we can love.
Oh, that is just, it's so touching. And I can feel that we are touching the hearts of everyone.
Thank you. You know, what's interesting, and again, I love this particular mystery when you can reframe the initial context of a song, you move it forward several decades, and suddenly it has been born into a new context. I mean, I didn't see that coming at all when I first wrote it, and that it is of service to a message in this moment is, I mean, that's real magic.
Well, it is, but I believe really nothing as ever kind of repeats itself. It has, when we give birth through creativity to sound and to, you know, art, they speak through the decades. They speak.
That's exactly true. I mean, that is why it's magnificent to wrap your soul in appreciation around great works that have simply not only remained but created a standard of excellence through the ages. It's really beautiful. Yeah, it's really beautiful.
Right. So I'm feeling that it would be really interesting too to pick up one of your audio recordings from way back. We're going back, aren't we?
Yes. This was a song that I wrote traveling on a bus with my band, seeing our beautiful nation for the first time from the roadside level, not flying over it, but actually seeing farmlands and seeing small towns and big towns and cities and, you know, rivers and streams and things that I wouldn't see growing up in Manhattan at the Bronx, and you can't really see it unless you drive through it. You can't really feel it unless you drive through it and see what it does to you as you're driving along and the wheels of the bus are under you. And somehow motion has always stirred a kind of a spiritual engine in me and allowed the ideas to come through. I guess if you know, when you have a baby and you're rocking the baby, you're creating that little baby engine to know that rocking is equated with comfort, right? Rocking is equated with safety and peace. And so when I started traveling and touring, you know, for me, performing is a full body engagement. And so I'm frequently exhausted and very vulnerable in the days after. So when you're going from gig to gig, you're pretty spent, you know, so you're just trying to find some way to restore your energy. And in looking out the windows of this bus, this tour bus, you know, and to see farmland and grassland and towns and stuff pass by, it would start releasing the fruits of thoughts. And I wrote this song called Lights of Dawn, and I can't even tell you specifically what I was going through other than that travelogue background. I think the song sort of speaks for itself in that it's literally postcards from the road. So that's what it is.
Boats rocking slow on the water, wheat fields just wave goodbye. Pictures to you of my roaming alone at night. Oh, what a surprise. Even I look on to see the light. so bright it comes easy to rest a weary soul. When holding on gets you weary, just let it go. What a surprise. Even I look on to see the lights of dawn. Sometimes you just believe that broken hearts will mend. In matters of the heart, you know, time is the oldest friend. Love comes when no one is looking, brings you home to stay. All of my life I've been longing to feel this way. Oh, what a surprise. You and I are gone to see the
Oh my.
All right.
So I have to remove the tears that were coming from my eyes.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh. Oof.
Yeah. Yeah. I have such a fondness for that younger woman. She was just trying to work it out and trying to understand what she was seeing and feeling and experiencing. And it's so touching, you know, it's so touching. I knew so little, I understood so little of the world and the world that was coming at me as an artist. But the urge to create and the worlds that were created in the midst of all of that confusion.
Yes.
Thank you, God.
Well, and what a beautiful message now for our world, because we are worldwide in that confusion these days.
Yes, we are. And
this is that calling to our hearts.
Yes.
To be creating.
Yes. Yes, that's
and
exactly.
And co-creating, right? This is new. This is new.
That's right. Yeah. I just was reading a quote somewhere that the ultimate regret for so many people at the end of their days is that they didn't live more boldly. Mm-hmm. And the truth is, you need courage to live a creative life, because you need the courage, among other things, to trust yourself.
Yes. Yes.
You know, to not only trust your ideas, but trust the feeling that they bring up in you when they are insisting on being expressed.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, many times you have to wrestle an idea to the ground, sometimes, which is exquisite. It just sort of blows through you and it's basically finished and you think, okay, more please. You know, it's really chiseling and chiseling and chiseling and refining and using finer tools the more you are into the artistic journey. I mean, I don't think I could write Lights of Dawn anymore, because that was such a younger more innocent. I don't use language like that anymore, but I have such of an appreciation of that younger woman who saw life through those eyes. Because what I know to be true in my work is that I always feel the thread of weariness in my songs.
Yes.
And I just think it's life. I just think it's how I navigate through life. It just leaves me a little weary and not paralyzed, not down for the count, but it's what I bring with me and what I've learned to integrate into what I've observed.
And it is a part, it's a totality, right? So we are,
it is.
All of that and more. So
right.
To not kind of try to push it out of ourselves.
That's exactly right. That's exactly right. I think, you know, weariness is a very precious thread. You know, it may be a burnished gold, but it's a golden kind of thread because, you know, it's the thread of the getting of wisdom. It's the opening yourself up to not only the experience, but the value of the experience, the opening up to the possible lesson that you needed to learn, awareness, all of it. I mean, it's literally the fabric of life that you weave, but you weave it through all of these incredible, purposeful, intentional threads. It's wild.
Yes. And then each one of us.
Yes.
Through our thread, our orchestra of threads, if you will, us are then sounding and vibrating. So every vibration, we are a sound, we're a frequency, and we are weaving ourselves into the grand tapestry.
Right.
Right. So that we can all we can all align. And I always talk about this, you know, let's take the lesson from the stars in the cosmos.
Yeah.
And each one of them is a light. So it's emitting a vibration, a frequency.
Right.
Yet they are not all in the same tuning, the same tonality, the same key.
Right.
And yet they weave together with an appreciation of one another, not with a collision that's to erupt, but rather, yes, there are dissonances, but dissonance is a necessary part of everything.
Exactly.
For us to appreciate the resonance.
Right.
Yeah.
Exactly right. Yeah. I think that is true in the world of music. It is true outside of the world of music, just the noise of humanity. Yeah. You just have to hope that maybe through music we find ways to help start dialogues, start discussions, galvanize, help people lift up and see what unites us more than what divides us. It certainly has happened in the past.
Yes, and it shall. And I'm writing this book on this whole idea of music and sound.
Right.
There was a something that came in as that just made me think about this. And it's like, well, what if we could all just have our own three notes or three sounds, and then, you know, this could be around the world, you could be on a didgeridoo or whatever instrument, and yet for each one to share and then each one to appreciate. And I don't know if you remember the book Oliver Sacks, The Man Who Mistook His Wife for a Hat.
Yes.
There was the chapter on the twin savants who had their own secret language through mathematics, and they would share with one another prime numbers. They were only primes, and they would go into the hundreds of digits. And so Oliver Sacks figured out what that language was. And so he sat down with a piece of paper and he wrote down a prime number. Now, this is what I'm talking about. Let's appreciate each other. And the twins looked at the number and they went, like they were relishing it. There was an appreciation of it. And it wasn't a feeling of, oh, no, this is my game, this is our game, you can't play. And it just speaks to how we are to now all be gathering in this World Sound Healing Day today. You know, there's tonalities and there's music coming from all around the world, but we're all tuned, we're all aligned, and we're all here to realign our human tapestry.
Amen.
Ah, yes.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, I think, and again, I think this pandemic, that's one of the unexpected gifts,
mm-hmm.
is to make the awareness of how discordant, how out of alignment we have been while we've been so busy and distracting and kicking things down the road to finish. I think in this moment of, I don't know, new awareness, I guess, well, awareness is new, to literally see what's around us, to see, to know.
Well, and I feel like it's almost rediscovering what we came in with to the world with sound and vision. You know, we, as babies, we heard those tones and those tunings, and we just knew.
Yeah.
You know, and so it's just kind of bringing everybody back together,
right,
with their higher self, so that we can create together.
I'm with you. Sign me up.
All right. We're starting our team. So speaking of the team and the train we're on here, let's share some more. Let's share another one of your videos. What are you feeling called to share today?
Sure. Well, I guess Don't Cry Out Loud would be nice in this moment. What do you think?
Oh, I agree.
Yeah. This video, again, it was re-recorded with some harmonic tweaks, and also none of the songs that we re-recorded have fade endings. I wanted them all to just end, because that's one of the most magnificent moments on a stage when you're performing in real time, is when the composition ends, the audience knows it, your musicians know it, you know it, the space is full, they respond. You know, the end, the repeat and fade stuff of earlier years on the radio was a construct to help them have enough time to get into a commercial or the news. And I really wanted this recording, and these new videos are part of what will be my 24th album called Review, and it'll probably be coming out in the spring. I really wanted one of those elements to have no fade. I wanted the composition to end. I wanted the listener to say, okay, we're done now. But I think Don't Cry Out Loud, this video is a reflection of what we have been going through in the early part of the pandemic. Again, the cancellation of every artistic venue on the planet, of all of the hardship for artists and lighting people and musicians and all people, you know, all the ancillary trades that help to bring the artist to light. So anyway, this is Don't Cry Out Loud, written by Carol Sager and the late and wonderful Peter Allen, both my dear friends.
Baby cried the day the circus came to town, 'cause she didn't want parades just passing by her. So she painted on a smile and took up with some clown, as she danced without a net up on the wire. I know a lot about her, 'cause you see, baby is an awful lot like me. Don't cry out loud, just keep it inside. Learn how to hide your feelings. Fly high and proud. remember you almost had it all. You almost had it all. Baby saw that when they pulled that big top down, they left behind her dreams among the litter, and that different kind of love she thought she found. There was nothing left but sawdust and some glitter. Oh, but baby can't be broke, 'cause you see, she had the finest teacher, that was me.
That is one of my all-time favorites from your songbook. I mean, is just, that song for me elicits so many memories, but it also, now, like you said, it's speaking so deeply to my heart during these times.
Yes.
And I know, to all the hearts with which, and it's such a joy to have these online platforms to be sharing with our world. And, you know, Jonathan Goldman, who, you know, created this 20 years ago, he was sharing with me, in, as we talked about doing some events, that it wasn't until last year everything was posted in his event page, but these were in-person events around the world. And I thought, but what a miracle of how many people worldwide now don't have to actually be sitting in California, and you and I aren't even in the same part of the state, and so we're here co-creating, and and we can be sharing this with everyone.
Yes, it's extraordinary. It's extraordinary. It's extraordinary to be an artist in this moment, and it's extraordinary to be an artist that has a long history behind me, because I've actually seen the quote-unquote marketplace change, so that so that the way I expected to get my music out, you know, from the beginning in the early 70s, to how I can now get my music out, not wait for permission from a record company or anything like that, I could just put it out myself. I mean, it's extraordinary. It's just unbelievable.
Yes, it is indeed
beautiful.
Good. So, well, we're on this beautiful, glorious roll because of our dialogue, and, you know, it always flows and it just brings it up. I really feel like it would be wonderful to also share your beautiful video of Midnight Blue.
Great.
Yeah.
Great. So
if you want to say a few words, and then I will have the video go in.
Wonderful. Well, I have a particular tenderness for Midnight Blue because it was my first hit. And the only thing harder than the first hit is the second hit, as they say. But it was a song written by Carol Sager and myself. And the reason I have a tenderness for it, besides the fact that it was the first for me, is again, that song has meant so much to so many people. It has given hope to so many people. It has, I've been told, through letters in the early days and through, you know, emails recently, that this song serenaded people through so many hard moments in their lives, in their relationships, during their teenagehoods, through the Vietnam War, through prison time, through helping couples decide to make a baby, through helping couples figure out how to talk through a hard patch in a relationship until there was resolution. All of that stuff that I had no awareness of when I was sitting in front of a blank piece of paper, and to have that feedback over these many years is humbling and touching. And so here is Midnight Blue.
Whatever it is, it'll keep till the morning. Haven't we both got better things to do? Midnight blue. Even the simple things become rough. Haven't we had enough? And I think we can make it one more time if we try. If we try one more time for all the old. One more time for all of the old. I think we can make it if we try. I think we can make it if we try. Looks like we're gonna make it, yes. Looks like we're gonna make it.
Oh, again, that's just glorious.
And, thank you.
You know, I think, you know, you and I did a special last year at New Year's, but this is feeling even more touching and more
intentional.
Intentional, for sure.
Yes. Yeah.
And and I'm just so, so overjoyed.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah.
Thank you. I'm so happy to be part of this. I salute you in your mission with World Sound Day. I really do.
Yes. Well, Jonathan Goldman, I mean, he's the driving spirit, and you know, his true belief is that we all co-create and to open this up. And
you know, to that point,
yes,
I really hope people understand that we all co-create. I don't think enough people know that, because unless you're raised with those messages in a family of creatives, I guess, maybe.
Yeah.
You don't know that, because if you don't see that in your surroundings, it's hard to intuit that, don't you think?
You know, I do. And I also think it's one of the things that we are, that's disrupting and erupting around the world, and that it has become this, we've been driven to this kind of attitude and action of not co-creating, because it's, you know, if you will, oh, I've got to win that
right.
job. I have to win that
right.
Grammy. I have to be the best.
Right.
And like when I was sharing the story about Oliver Sacks and the twins, the twins didn't look at the numbers and go, no, you can't play. This is ours. That wasn't there. And so when we look at, they were allowing him into that world and they were co-creating.
Right. Right. But let me just add
yes.
on to your point.
Yeah.
I think these days it's not, and maybe it's always been, but it's not about being the best, it's about being the most powerful.
Oh, perfect. I think it's a combination, but yes, the power.
It's the power.
That's it.
Is just, the power is like eating too much sugar.
And it takes our strings of ourselves and it twangs them. It puts them so out of tune, you can't really...
I know. It's
and we clash with one another in that.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. I know for myself, when my thinking is getting too anxious or spinning
yeah.
or the world at large is just making me nuts, I turn on the classical station or I turn on Ella, and those long thoughts, those long melodic lines, accompanied sometimes by those long lyrical lines, where musical lines can be developed.
Yes.
And developed and developed. And when you think the composer can't go any further, they do go further. And you think, okay, I can breathe again. I'm breathing deeply again. I forgot I hadn't taken a deep breath in 20 minutes. I'm breathing again. I'm back in my body again. I'm no longer out of my mind. I'm in my mind again. I'm in my spirit.
Yes. And it's all aligning. Well, Melissa, you know, this is just such a delight to to be sharing your beautiful stories and music with our world. And I feel for our beautiful sharing for this special World Sound Healing Day, why don't you just take us home for our audience, okay?
Thank
you. What would you like to share?
First, thank you for the opportunity. You are a very special person to be open to the World Healing Day. And thank you for inviting me to be a part of it. I'd like to share this song that I wrote with Pam Rose called Still Myself. It's a song of experience, and I believe the getting of wisdom. So I'm happy to share that with you.
All right. Well, I am going to get it ready, and here it comes.
I thought I'd live by your side and die in your arms. We were close as the wind to the rain. I thought I'd take on your dreams and bathe in your light, but this moment is all that remains. And I know I'll make something from nothing, but that first step's the hardest to take. So I will still myself, conquer my fears, and I will still myself, and cushion the fall, and I will still myself, so deep in the silence till I recall I'm still myself after all. I know that I've never walked in these shoes, and your footprints have washed in the sand. No, I can't stay forever waiting by the shore, but my life feels like some foreign land. Sometimes we all feel like strangers, just trying to find our way home. So I will still myself and conquer my fears, and I will still myself and cushion the fall, and I will still myself so deep in the silence till I recall I'm still myself after all. In the whisper of memories, in my heart you are with me, and a part of the journey is having the faith to go on. So I will still myself, conquer my fears, and I will still myself, cushion the fall, and I will still myself, so deep in the silence till I still myself, still myself after all.
Oh, that is just beautiful.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And would you care to share from your heart any particular story or anything around that of comfort and how it you know, for you or for the world? I mean, the words itself, but.
Well, it was a song of experience. A relationship didn't work out. Realizing that my expectations were not managed, and I had to learn from it. I've gotten to the point where when things don't work out, I have to surrender to what is teachable, what I can learn from it, what I need to learn from it. And I did. And you know, I've gotten to a point where I'm grateful for the lessons. Even when I stumble, I just find that the universe is simply trying to teach me what I need to learn. And what I know to be true is my journey is simply unlike anybody else's on the planet. So if that song can give somebody else permission to breathe through whatever they are wrestling to gain clarity about, you know, sometimes you just have to surrender in order to see it. You need to surrender your heart so that it'll open, and whatever the wisdom is comes to you and comes up to your mind, where you think, oh, that's what this was all about.
Yes. And the beauty in how, in the words of the song, I'm still myself. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes when we lose relationships, and many people around the world have lost many things and many people through this pandemic, yet that message.
Well, what I'm particularly fond of in this song, it's that particular lyrical device where you keep using the same word, but it changes its meaning.
Yes.
To still yourself and then find you're still yourself. That's the whole point, you know, that you can't get to that nugget of wisdom until you still yourself, which is more than being quiet, I've found. It's behind being quiet, below being quiet, where you actually are open in your own stillness. And then you frequently have the aha moment.
Yes. Oh, well, thank you so much, dear friend, for sharing the gifts of your beautiful voice and music with our world and the messages.
And thank you for allowing me to be part of this beauty that you've created.
And to all of our audiences around the world, we send you much love and blessings.